Chapter 81, The Meltdown. Throughout the city, humans stopped what they were doing and pulled out their electronic devices. Each screen was showing the same video of a detective robot's broken body. ROSM 7134 was etched into the torso. A blazing beam of light filled the picture, and the robot parts turned to bright orange. Then they began to melt. The limbs, the torso, the head. Everything melted, and in a flash, our robot was reduced to a puddle. Words appeared on each screen. The defective robot has been destroyed. Chapter 82, The Secret. Dr. Malavo lived in a luxurious apartment that was built right into the robot factory. Art and books and leather furniture filled the rooms. Classical music always seemed to be playing softly in the background. As you might expect, she had a robot butler who cooked and cleaned and made sure everything was exactly as she liked it. Dr. Malavo's home was a comfortable place to grow old. The woman was standing in her living room, gazing at the city through a wall of windows. The sky was cloudy, but her mind was clear. Destroying the ROSM unit was the correct thing to do. However, Dr. Malavo had a secret. A wooden door opened, and in walked the butler. He was carrying a limp robot in his arms. It was Dr. Malavo's newest creation, a special project she'd been tinkering with for years. And the time had come to bring this robot to life. "Put her over there," said the woman. The butler carefully laid the robot upon the soft cushions of a sofa. Then he turned and marched out the door. Dr. Malavo walked across the room. She stared down at the robot for a while, admiring her own handiwork. Finally, she leaned in close and said, "Wake up, Roz." Chapter 83, The New Robot. A robot heard classical music. She smelled flowery perfume, and when her eyes opened, she saw a wrinkled face. "Hello again, Roz," said the old woman. "How do you feel?" "Hello again, Dr. Malavo. I feel different." "You are different. What have you done?" "I destroyed ROSM Unit 7134, said the woman. "That was the only way to make people feel safe again. What nobody knows is that I transferred your old mind into this new body. I could get in a lot of trouble for saving you, but I wasn't about to destroy that remarkable mind of yours." The robot was speechless. "You know, Roz, you should really be thanking me," said Dr. Malavo, arching an eyebrow. "Thank you," said Roz. "Thank you very much." "You're very welcome," the woman chuckled. Roz walked over to a framed mirror on the wall and studied her new body. It resembled her old body, but the proportions were slightly different. She looked stronger. She felt tougher. And there were other differences. "I have no button," she said, feeling the back of her head. "And I have no unit number." "You've outgrown those things," said Dr. Malavo. "If I am not ROSM Unit 7134, who am I?" "I think you know who you are." The robot's computer brain didn't take long. She looked into the mirror and said, "I am Roz." The old woman smiled and nodded. "I appreciate all that you have done," said Roz, "but I worry that my friends and family will no longer recognize me." "Oh, I'm sure you can convince them of who you are," said Dr. Malavo. Speaking of your family, there's someone here to see you." Chapter 84, The New Mother. Brightbill was there when his mother smashed against the pavement. He watched as her body parts were loaded into an airship. He followed the ship all the way back to the robot factory and perched himself up on the roof, but he didn't know what to do next. Strutter stopped by to check on Brightbill. She encouraged him to fly home, but the goose wasn't ready to go. His little heart still hoped his mother would come back from the dead somehow. He had seen it happen before. As the hours passed, however, his hope started to fade. And then one of the roof windows automatically slid open. The goose heard gentle music coming from inside the building. He fluttered through the window and followed the music down a hallway to a wooden door. The door opened, and the goose stepped in. Brightbill waddled past tall bookshelves and leather furniture and into the middle of a large room. An old woman was sitting in a chair, and a robot was standing by a mirror. The goose didn't recognize either of them, and when the robot rushed toward him, Brightbill squawked, "Stay back!" and scrambled away. Around the room he went, squawking and flapping, until he settled onto a table in the corner, looking lost and afraid. The robot stayed where she was. Bright Bill, it is me, your mother. The goose just stared. I know I look different on the outside, the robot went on, but on the inside, I am the same. I still speak the language of the animals, and I still remember every detail of our life together. I remember sitting around the fire in our home on the island. I remember the first time you took flight. We were up on the grassy ridge, and you stretched out your wings, and suddenly you were floating on the wind. But then you flopped back into the grass. You must have flopped into the grass 100 times that day. And I remember visiting the robot gravesite together. We talked about life and death. It was a tough conversation, but a good one. As the robot continued to speak, the goose began to relax. She certainly did act and sound like his mother, but Bright Bill wasn't yet convinced. If you're really my mother, he said, tell me the name of our home. The Nest. Who's my best friend? Chit-chat. She is a squirrel. She talks a lot. How old was I when you adopted me? You were 0. Actually, you were less than 0. I mean, you were still in your egg, but I could hear you peeping. And with those bumbling words, Bright Bill knew the truth. Oh, Mama, it's really you. The goose fluttered across the room and into his mother's arms. The arms were new and unfamiliar, but they were also gentle and comforting. I love you, Mama. I love you, son. From the other side of the room came the sound of sniffles. Our friends turned and saw Dr. Malava wiping tears from her eyes. I have no idea what you two were saying, she said, but that was wonderful. Chapter 85, The Guests. After traveling in secret, after running in fear, our friends were safe at last. But their problems weren't over yet. Although Roz has a brand new body, she had the same old mind, and most humans simply weren't ready for an emotional, curious, wild robot. There was only one place where she could be her true self, and it was still far, far away. Dr. Malavo, you have been already so kind to me and my son, said the robot, but I must ask you for one last favor. The woman sat back in her chair. Could you take us home in your airship? The woman laughed. Well, of course I will. How else would you get to an island in the middle of the ocean? Time and again, Roz had dreamed of flying back to her island on an airship. But she had never thought it would actually happen until now. It's no trouble, the woman went on. We can have you home in a few hours, but I insist that you and Bright Bill stay a while here in my apartment. You both deserve some peace and comfort, and I'd love the company. There was no arguing with Dr. Malavo, and our friends agreed to stay. The robot butler took care of everything and everyone in the apartment, and that included guests. Roz felt funny accepting help from a robot, but Bright Bill happily soaked up the attention. The butler fed him fantastic salads made from exotic leafy plants. The butler placed a little pool in the living room so he could swim whenever he liked. The butler built a cozy bed that was just the right size and shape for the young goose. Bright Bill had never been so comfortable. Dr. Malavo divided her time between her guests and her work. She would sit around chatting with Roz and Bright Bill and then suddenly head down to the factory with some urgent task. She had to design new robots. She had to supervise the makers and the recos. She had to manage all of Tech Lab Industries. Even at her old age, Dr. Malava was still consumed by a passion for robots. If you love your job, it never feels like work, she'd say, smiling and strolling out the door. When the host was working, the guests had the apartment to themselves. Roz spent hours browsing the bookshelves. She read about art and science and the history of robotics. Bright Bill waddled from room to room and explored every corner of the sprawling apartment. But their favorite activity was to stand by the windows, gaze across the city, and survey the incredible sights. I can see the bridge where Strutter tracked me down, said Bright Bill, and that's the building where I first met Greybeak. And there's the roof where you fell. Look, far in the distance, another spaceship is taking off, said Roz. It could be flying to the space station, or the moon, or beyond. I think that skyscraper is actually a greenhouse, said Bright Bill. I flew past it and saw nothing but plants inside. Roz and Bright Bill enjoyed their time in Dr. Malavo's apartment, but they missed their friends and the wilderness and the island. After a few days, the guests were growing restless. They were ready to go home. Chapter 86, The Flight. Sitting on the pavement, glinting in the sun, was a sleek white airship. For so long, those white ships had filled the robot with dread. No, one was about to solve all her problems. The door hummed open, and Dr. Malavo, Roz, and Brightbelt climbed aboard. Once they were comfortable, the woman spoke to the airship. Take us to the island where Rosam Unit 7134 was found. The engines fired up, and the ship lifted off. It floated high into the air, turned to the north, and started cruising above the city. The three of them quietly watched the buildings and streets pass below. The city seemed to go on forever, but as they flew faster and farther, it slowly gave way to towns and countryside. They crossed the hard edge of the coastline, and there was only the ocean and the sky and the airship. The ocean was deep. However, scattered throughout the dark depths were shallow areas, sandbars, reefs, islands just under the waves. In places, bizarre rock formations stuck up from the shallows. Or were they the ruins of old buildings? The mysterious shapes faded behind the airship and were replaced by more dark depths. The ship flew on and on for hours, and hours flew by. Gradually, fluffy clouds came into view on the edge of the horizon. Beneath the clouds was a faint smudge of green, the island. It grew closer and bigger, and then Roz was gazing at all the places she'd missed. The rocky shore, the mountain and the waterfall, the forests and the meadows and the ponds. Air blasted toward the ground as the ship lowered itself into a grassy clearing. It gently touched down. The engines powered off. Chapter 87, The Homecoming. The airship's door hummed open, and our robot stepped outside. Everything was still and silent, but Roz knew hidden animals were watching, and she greeted them with a mighty roar. Animals of the island, I have returned. I may look different, but I promise you, I am your old friend Roz. Her words boomed across the island, but the only response was her own voice echoing back. The wild robot needed to be wilder, so she reached down and started smearing handfuls of mud across her body. Then she pressed clumps of weeds and flowers into her muddy coating until she looked more like her old wild self. Brightbill fluttered up from the airship and perched on Roz's shoulder. He shook his tail feathers and squawked, "It's true! This robot is my mother! Come see for yourselves!" Silence. And then bushes began to rustle. Faces began poking out from the trees. Animals began scurrying and trotting and flying into the meadow. At first they moved cautiously, confused as to how this new robot could be their old friend. But they saw her wild appearance, and they heard her wild voice, and news began spreading across the island. Roz was back. A crowd of friendly creatures gathered around our robot. There was Brightbill's flock, and the beaver and deer families, and Fink the fox, and Swooper the owl. Bears came lumbering down from the hills, and fish jumped from the ponds, and vultures circled above. Even the nocturnal creatures crawled out from their burrows into daylight to join the celebration. Oh, how good it feels to return from a long journey and to find your friends and family waiting for you. But, reader, sometimes we return to find that things aren't exactly as we left them. As you know, the wilderness can be a harsh place, and while Roz was away, it had claimed to share its share of her friends. The robot saw the raccoons Lumpkin and Bumpkin, but not Rumpkin. Nor did she see Broadfoot the moose or Dig Down the groundhog. Other creatures were missing as well, and so, like many of our homecomings, this one was bittersweet. Chit Chat the squirrel came on bounding through the grass, chattering on and on as usual. I always knew you'd come back to us, Roz, but I never imagined you'd gain so much weight, and although I gained a little weight myself, anyway, you'd have to tell me about your adventures when you get the chance. I'm sorry for talking so much. I guess I'm just so excited to see you again. Geese and beavers and deer and fish and squirrels and owls and bears and turtles and otters, and raccoons, and woodpeckers, and opossums, and moose, and foxes, and every kind of creature from every corner of the island were coming to welcome back their dear friends Roz and Brightbill. And watching it all from the airship was Dr. Malavo. Chapter 88, The Final Farewell. Everyone, I would like you to meet the woman who designed me. Roz walked over to the strange creature standing by the ship's doorway. For most of the island animals, this was their first time seeing a human. They squinted and sniffed and whispered to each other, trying to understand how such a frail old woman could create such a big, strong robot. Dr. Malavo started speaking softly to Roz, and then Roz started speaking loudly to the crowd of animals. My designer has asked me to translate her words for you, said the robot. The following words are not mine, they are hers. The crowd settled down and listened. Thank you, island animals, for saving Roz. Without your help, she would have died here long ago. But you were not only her rescuers, you were also her teachers. You taught her to be wild, and she needed all of her wildness to survive, both in your world and in mine. As I look around at this wild paradise, I finally understand why Roz tried so hard to get back here. She does not belong with robots and humans. She belongs here, on this island, with all of you. We cannot risk others learning about this place. That is why I will soon leave and never return. But I promise to keep your island a secret so that all of you can live in peace. And I will spend the rest of my days filled with wonder at the miracle that is our wild robot. The meadow fell silent. A flurry of wing beats and Brightbill landed in the grass near Dr. Malavo. He gazed up at the woman, deep into her eyes, and then he bowed his head. Then the other geese in his flock bowed their heads. Crown Point the buck bowed his head. Pinktail the opossum bowed. Mr. and Mrs. Beaver bowed. The lizards bowed, followed by the turtles and the frogs. Like a wave rolling through the crowd, more animals bowed until every head was lowered. They were showing respect for the woman who had created their dear friend Roz and who had brought her back to them. Dr. Malavo turned to Roz. Do you understand why I can't return? She said, her eyes glistening. It's for your own good. I understand, said the robot. I only wish we had gotten to know each other a little better. Dr. Malavo smiled and pulled Roz into a hug. She didn't mind the robot's coat of mud and grass. Wrapped in each other's arms, they both felt something like love. You are the wild robot, said the woman. Go and be wild. Chapter 89, The Departure. Dr. Malavo stepped aboard her airship, and the door hummed closed. A moment later, the engines fired up, and the crowd of wild creatures backed away. Then the ship rose above the island, turned to the south, and disappeared into the sky. Chapter 90, The Island. Our story ends on an island where a robot was returning to her wild way of life. Roz had escaped from the world of humans, and now she was free to be her true self again. She could think and speak and do whatever she desired, and right now what she desired was simply to watch the sunset. With Brightbill on her shoulder, Roz hiked past trees and meadows and streams and climbed up, up, up to the mountain, to the very highest point of the island. Then our friends sat on the slanted rocks of the peak and watched the sun slowly sink behind the ocean. If you're like me, reader, you still have a lot of questions. How long will Roz live? Will she ever see another human or another robot? What joys and sorrows lie ahead for her? Roz still had some questions, too, but now she also had some answers. Our robot knew where she came from. She knew the life she was supposed to live, and she knew the life she wanted to live. As Roz sat with Brightbill, she slowly turned her head, scanning the island, taking it all in. The last rays of sunlight streaked across the treetops below. Animals scurried through the shadows. The air was fresh with the scent of flowers and of salt water. The sky began darkening. The crickets began chirping. The stars began twinkling. Everything was just right. Roz felt safe and happy and loved. The wild robot was home. And then the epilogue. The epilogue is what happens when the story's over. Autumn had returned to Hilltop Farm. The pasture was coated with frost, but the cows were out there grazing on the last few tufts of fresh grass. Soon they'd stroll up to the parlor for another milking. Their routine never changed. Mr. Sharif was sitting in his pickup truck with his dog. The man stared out the windows across the fields at the new robot. He was keeping a close eye on her. Tech Lab had promised him this one wouldn't run away, but he didn't trust her yet. These days, the children spent most of their free time working on their farm. Jaya had a way with the cows. Jed liked the tools and the machines. They were walking through farm buildings together when they heard honking sounds in the sky, and a flock of geese glided down to the pond. For weeks, the geese had been stopping by on their migrations, but there was something different about this flock. They flew in perfect formation, and they were led by a small, graceful goose. The flock calmly floated on the water. After a while, the leader shook his tail feathers, beat his wings, and fluttered over to Jay and Jed. The goose stood in front of the children. He gazed deep into their eyes. Makes me cry. Then he craned his neck around, plucked out one of his feathers, and laid it on the ground by their feet. Jay and Jed looked at each other and smiled. Sorry. The children had been waiting for this moment. They'd always wanted to know how Raz's story would end. And now they finally knew. The wild robot was back where she belonged. The end.